Progressives in the House are threatening to block a bill put forward by centrist Democrats. So now this is the drug pricing bill. This is H.R. 3, the Elijah Cummings Lower Drug Costs Now Act. So now, wait a minute. Why would progressives be blocking a bill that promises to lower prescription drugs? Well, it turns out that this bill is not nearly progressive enough and would not actually do a whole lot. So now, the Progressive Caucus, by the way, is in the House of Representatives, led by Representative Pramila Jayapal and Mark Pocan. So now they argue that this bill is far too modest and, again, would do very little to actually reduce prescription drug prices. So now part of this act would allow the government to negotiate on the prices of only 25 prescription drugs. But hey, don't worry. This does get expanded, by the way. See, over the next 10 years, if this enacted, it would expand to a total of 35 prescription drugs that you can lower the prices on. Bold. Bold action. So now, it also locks that in for about 10 years, not allowing any additions or changes. So, sorry, you're locked in for 10 years. 10 years. All right, so now, obviously, progressives are not thrilled with this piece of legislation. And you know what? I actually believe that Elijah Cummings would also not be pleased about this if he were still around. He's, of course, the late representative, because he actually had a much stronger piece of legislation that he that Bernie Sanders had worked on with him. So it's Elijah's bill. Bernie Sanders worked on it with him, and yet centrist Democrats decided to take his name and put it to a bill that has no progressive legislation in it. Disastrous. So now, David Dan and Ryan Grimm, they wrote a great article for The Intercept the other day, and they explain the political fight that's going on here. They said that the tensions of the bill are rooted in a provision that will, for the first time, allow direct price negotiations between the government and major drug companies, creating an exemption to a non-interference clause banning such negotiations instituted in 2003. As written, however, the bill sets a floor of just 25 high-cost drugs that will be negotiated per year, rising to 35 in the 10th year of the bill's enactment. The CPC and drug affordability advocates believe this floor will operate as a ceiling and that higher minimum of negotiations ought to be mandated. Right. Now, progressive caucus leaders also would like to see the non-interference clause stricken entirely, gone, so that the government can negotiate for all medications, all prescription drugs, which I believe makes the most sense. Other countries have a similar, or I should say other countries do not have that non-interference clause. And therefore, the same drugs that get manufactured here in America are much, much cheaper elsewhere because you allow the government to negotiate. So it's ridiculous to have that clause in any piece of, in government at all. And even more insulting, I should say, to have a supposed progressive piece of legislation put forward by the Democrats to only allow 25 for 10 years. That is ridiculous, man. Now, in addition, another problem here is the uninsured will not see any benefits from price negotiations and will be forced to pay whatever price drug companies want them to. So no help for the millions of people who are uninsured. No help for the millions of people. And by the way, a lot of people have been documented. We've done stories where we talk about people that have died because they don't have insurance and they ration things like insulin. They can't afford it anymore. And so this bill would do nothing for those people. So, but we're not done with this, okay? Now, Pelosi's office also decided to strip out an amendment that Jayapal passed to the House Education and Labor Committee, which would expand proposed rebates for excessive price spikes to certain drugs under Medicare to also cover group health plans. Now, instead of having the Secretary of Labor conduct a feasibility study on the expansion and then affirmatively devise regulations to accomplish it, Pelosi's office threw out everything but the study, which Dan explains is how Congress kills policy. Great. So now, this doesn't make any sense at all, because when you look at the politics of it, any bill is not going to make it out of the graveyard of Mitch McConnell. So really, what, and this is how, you know, the politics of it, right? This bill is serves as a message to the electorate. Hey, these are our priorities. And yet Nancy Pelosi can't seem to do something progressive, even when a majority of Americans and even Republicans have said that they want to do something about high prescription drug costs. Well, this bill would do something about it if you leave the actual progressive measures in it. It would send to the electorate, like I said, a message that, hey, we're strong, we're with you. Instead, the message Pelosi is sending is, we agree more with Republicans about this, which is why we're continuously trying to reach out to Republicans, even though Mitch McConnell will never let this pass. And I'm going to show you the result of this later. But here's the thing. Why not make this more progressive? Why wouldn't they make it more progressive? And then force Republicans to vote against it, as they plan on doing it anyway, and then use that vote in attack ads against Republicans. This is what I was saying yesterday. Democrats suck at politics because, and let me give you the reason why. It's not that they're stupid. It's that their donors are also pharmaceutical companies. So, which is why, as the American Prospect documented on Friday, Pelosi and her staff, led by top health policy aide Wendell Primus, have frozen out progressives from deliberations over the bill. They're quoted as in the article as saying they have exerted extreme control over the process. Extreme control. Pelosi and Primus then, after freezing out progressives, went to find a compromise with Donald Trump, with the White House. Now, guess how that went. Even with all the stripping out of everything that's progressive in this bill, Trump panned it on Twitter. Of course. And now this bill that Pelosi is going to send out as a message to the voters that, hey, man, look, we're on your side. Here's our drug bill. Still has all that watered down stuff in it. Disaster. Absolute disaster. Now, in this fight, you can see it's progressives versus the centrists. And what's important about this is that it's basically going to show if progressives can stick together, the Progressive Caucus, and actually fight and stand up against the establishment, against the centrists. Now, there are 233 Democrats in the House of Representatives. Pelosi needs 216. And that's because, of course, Elijah Cummings' seat is empty, and Representative Katie Hill's seat is empty. Normally, they would have 218. And so, if just 18 of the caucus's 98 members vote this rule down, then it would fail. And Pelosi would have to turn to progressives in order to pass the bill. That would prove that progressives do have power here. Now, if they don't, well, then that's a huge problem, because then that would show that progressives don't have power, that they can't actually muster effective resistance against the establishment, and therefore Pelosi can go back to ignoring them, which again, she's basically been doing, right? But if they actually are successful in calling her bluff, well, then they would show that they have real power within the caucus. And this is important because really it's a fight for the soul of the party, right? If we ever want to see good policy, then we've got to start playing good politics. And that's not what's happening. And so now, how likely is are the Progressive Caucus going to be able to stand up? How likely are they going to actually win this battle? Well, a Democratic source confirmed to The Intercept that a substantial number of progressives would vote against the rule if certain priorities, restoring the Jayapal Amendment, increasing the minimum drugs negotiated, striking the non-interference clause down, and making sure the uninsured benefit were not included in the final text. So that's the line. Here is what progressives want, and AOC is among one of them. She says, put this stuff back in, and yeah, we'll vote for it. But if you leave it out, then no, we're not going to vote for it because it's not at all progressive, and it's not at all something that's actually going to help the American people. That's actually what we're here to do. So now, again, they need 18 people to vote against the rule. And so Pelosi, though, now here's Pelosi saying, well, we don't think that you're going to get that power. Now, Pelosi's aide told The Hill, quote, Representatives Pocan and Jayapal are gravely misreading the situation if they try to stand in the way of the overwhelming hunger for H.R. 3 within the House Democratic Caucus and among progressive members. The Lower Drug Costs Now Act will pass next week. Look at the condescension that you get from Nancy Pelosi. It will pass. So the message that she wants to send out is we don't really care about you. We're going to pass something that is so weak and watered down and only covers or allows the government to negotiate for 25 drugs. And that actually helps the pharmaceutical industry by then locking that in and allowing no changes for 10 years, no additional drugs for 10 years. That's your message. That's what you want to tell the American people. Look at what I did for you. We got you a crumb. Now be happy. No, progressives are absolutely right in this. So Pelosi's not going to move. So the Progressive Caucus, they need to get together and they need to realize, and they haven't done this before, that Pelosi's not their friend. I mean, you're the Progressive Caucus. Be progressive and actually be strong. And stand up against Pelosi. I know, right? But here's the thing. I think you need to start realizing that you're not going to get anything done because Nancy Pelosi, it's not just the Republicans, it's Nancy Pelosi that is also going to stand against you. And I know, like, people are trying to, make connections and, you know, working together with fellow party members in order to get things done. But here's the thing. Even though a lot of progressives are strong and saying, hey, look, this is what I'll vote for, you got to understand that your fellow Democrats are not going to work with you. Your fellow Democrats in the centrist wing are not going to help you. You might as well treat them as if they're part of the Republican Party, at least on some of these issues, because they are actively the opposition. Pelosi does not share progressive values. And so that's the truth. She is paid for by pharmaceutical industry, the pharmaceutical industry, the health insurance industry. She is paid to protect their interests, which align against the American people. This is why the progressives in the caucus need to stick together and need to challenge her and actually win on this issue. Vote against this rule. Shoot it down. Nuke it so that she has to come back to you. Say, okay. What do you want? What do you want in this bill? That's how politics is played. So now, will it happen? Again, I don't know. They don't need that many, 18. And which is why, of course, it helps that Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren have both spoken out against this rule, against stripping out the progressive parts of this rule. Now, is that going to be enough? I don't know. Again, I don't know. But I do think it might help. Now, Dan writes, quote, because Pelosi finds the bill's passage to be an important marker of the House continuing to govern amid the impeachment inquiry, it's become a viable fight for progressives. A loss would be extremely embarrassing to Pelosi and would signal to that progressives do have the power to dictate terms on policy when they so desire, or at least can't be utterly ignored. But also adds the danger. If the House manages to pass it without improvements, i.e. not enough Democrats support progressives, then the opposite conclusion can be drawn. So not only is this fight about policy, it's about politics, strategy, and really the viability of progressives in the House. This is an important fight for the movement, because if we lose, Pelosi wins, they can go back to saying that progressives are completely irrelevant and can continue going further right and passing terrible legislation that caters to Republicans that Republicans aren't going to pass anyway. But if you have progressives that win and we get a bill passed through the House, which again, is not going to get passed by Republicans, but sends out that important message and says, we are strong, we are going to protect consumers, we are going to protect the uninsured, and we have the establishment with us now, it again sends the message that Democrats actually care about helping Americans and not corporations. That's a good message to send. And amid the impeachment hearings, proceedings that are happening now, this may be the most important fight going on in the House. And so I hope progressives stay strong and actually do win this. Hey guys, hopefully you enjoyed that free video. Now I'm going to have to ask you a favor. Between the demonetization and the YouTube algorithm messing around with view counts, etc., we're having a hard time adjusting to the new YouTube reality, which is where you guys come in. See, we have a Patreon, patreon.com/TYTNation, set up to help us rely on the viewers, instead of big corporate ads. Look, you know the show. You know I'm not in favor of big corporations anyway. So help us transition away from relying on the ad model to pay the bills and sign up to be a patron, patreon.com/TYTNation. That goes a long way to help us keep the lights on. And you guys will know that you're supporting independent progressive media.